In the Marlborough Sons. Good evening. The commuter airliner crashed after the plane struck overhead power lines stretched across Tory Channel. One 12-year-old girl has survived, and she lost her parents and two sisters in the accident. Amongst the other victims were three members of another family. Police hold no hopes of any more survivors.
And as time goes on, the chances of further survival becomes less and less, but will continue until all hope is abandoned.
Meantime, the power cables across Tory Channel are just about invisible to aircraft, even those hovering less than 100 metres away. Bill Reed is the helicopter pilot employed to string the lines up in 1982, and he says as soon as they were up, he was calling for some form of marking to be put on them.
They've never been put on. There's a lot of people have written to the department and asked why these markers have never been put on, and nothing's ever happened.
How do you feel that they've never been put on?
I'm angry.
Police divers are on the scene this evening in an almost vain attempt to find sunken wreckage.
This is the crashed aircraft, a Cessna 402, the ill-fated Air Albatross Flight 248. Today's accident follows a series of incidents with Air Albatross planes. This year, emergency services at Wellington Airport have been kept busy with the airline. Another of their Cessnas made no less than six emergency landings this year for a variety of faults that include burst tyres, an engine fire, and suspected undercarriage failure. Air Albatross was one of the first of a growing flock of third-level airlines that took to the air in late 1981, plying the route between Wellington, Blenheim, and Nelson.
The name of the crash survivor is Cindy Mosey. She's 12 and lives in Nelson. Her mother and father and two sisters were also on the plane. The names of those missing are the pilot, Mr. Roger Phipps of Lower Hutt, and his passengers, two families from the Nelson area, Richard and Diane Grayson of Stoke, and their daughter Kirsty, aged 11, and Mr. Paul and Mrs. J. Mosey and their two daughters, Carla, 13, and Alicia, 7. 35 children are in Rotoura Hospital tonight after swallowing poison during a lunchtime prank at their school yesterday. Children mistook a jar of deadly copper sulphate for jelly crystals and had to be rushed to hospital for emergency treatment.
This afternoon, the children who are aged from 6 to 11 were in a comfortable condition in Rotoura Hospital. But when they were admitted yesterday, it was a different story. Most were suffering from stomach pains and nausea, and all were given an immediate stomach washout before taking an antidote for the poison. The drama began at the Tohira Primary School in Taupo yesterday lunchtime. During the break, an alert principal spotted something suspicious. He saw one of his pupils clutching a small jar. And this is what caused the problem, some copper sulfate crystals in a vitamin C bottle. It seems some children found this on a farm and brought it to school. They told their friends that it was jelly crystals, and they encouraged them to dip their fingers in and have a lick. The copper sulfate crystals are extremely poisonous. Taken in sufficient quantity, they can cause liver or kidney damage and even death. Fortunately, the school's principal realised what they were and raised the alarm.
And we rang the poisons centre in Dunedin and found out about the toxicity of this chemical and realised that even a small dose was quite lethal to young children, and so we decided to take those children who were suffering from the stomach pains up to the hospital so they could be treated and inform parents to take the children who might have been in contact with it to their local doctor.
So a fleet of ambulances took 30 or so of the poisoned children to Rotoura Hospital. Today they're still nursing sore tummies, but it seems they're well on the way to recovery. It appears none swallowed a large quantity of the poison.
At the moment I've been treated by intravenous fluids. The antidote to the poison has been given in the intravenous fluids to them. And they're on fluids only by mouth at this stage.
Almost all of the children seem to have swallowed the poison of their own volition, but it's been reported that one child was forced to swallow it. Meanwhile, many parents are shocked at how a seemingly innocent prank nearly became a major tragedy.
Farmers are being urged to put away their checkbooks as part of a nationally coordinated strategy for economic survival. Federated Farmers wants its members to stop spending to make others hurt, as they say they're being hurt themselves.
The Federated Farmers strategy was fine-tuned at a meeting of Canterbury farmers this morning, the first of a series to be held around the country. In their efforts to lower both interest rates and the Kiwi dollar, the farmers plan a collective refusal to spend on anything, a move they hope will force down costs such as killing charges and transport. As well, the tactic is designed to make the wider community appreciate their plight by sharing it.
It's not a vindictive tactic, but it is a deliberate tactic, because we're hurting very much out there, and other sectors have just got to hurt if we're going to come through this.
And in Ashburton today, at the opening of new rural bank premises, further evidence of discontent with interest rates. Recalling that last December, Agriculture Minister Colin Moyle said if the rates weren't falling by now, he'd be wanting a one-way ticket to Queensland. A group of farmers offered him one, with the comment,
"Well, I'm a farmer too, you know, I'm getting the same rough trip."
The minister refused to accept it.
There could be a national strike if the employers and the government don't back away from their hard line in the current wage round. This was one of the options discussed at a mass meeting of union delegates in Auckland today. They promised support for the engineers' union and all others who want a wage rise of at least 17%.
Nearly 1,000 delegates crammed into the Kingsgate Convention Centre for a meeting called by the Auckland Trades Council. Many were for a hard line, including bans on exports, especially after Engineers Union Secretary Mr. Rex Jones said the employer's attack on his union and refusal to pay was an attack on all. The president of the FOL, Mr. Jim Knox, slammed the finance ministers and had this message for the government.
It's not a question of us having a confrontation with the Labor government. But I'm afraid that unless you heed our voice, you will put yourself out as a government. We won't be responsible for that.
Afterwards, as delegates left for the job sites, Mr. Knox told newsmen he was off to see the Prime Minister and the Minister of Labour to give them the workers' views.
I have no doubt that the employers will want to try and keep the wage increases down as low as they can. Yet here we have the Prime Minister saying now, and perhaps he's got a bit of sanity into his mind now, that 15 or 15.5%, they can live with that. Well, I'm afraid that he's going to have to live with a bit more than that from some of the union's claims.
Former MP John Kirk says regardless of how he fares in court, he'll never live in New Zealand again by choice. Mr. Kirk, who's been released on bail, will face three charges under the Insolvency Act when he appears in the Wellington District Court on Monday. He's being represented by top criminal lawyer Mr. Mike Bungay, free of charge.
Returning to New Zealand with $3 American to his name, John Kirk spent a quiet few days assessing his position since getting bail on Wednesday night. He's also brought home a chest infection and he's 10 kilograms lighter than he was when he left after losing weight in the Dallas County Jail. He says he's exhausted and angry after undergoing 14 weeks without sunlight, exercise or a decent square meal. Memories of being held in a 30 by 60 foot holding tank with 32 others are still strong.
Some of the Mariel Castro criminal people that were exported to America that America now cannot deport, Mexicans and of course whites. They ranged in offences from attempted murder with handguns through to conspiracy to import 1,000 kilos of cocaine.
What was your worst moment?
I think the absolute unknown of the potential violence that was there. 28 people have been killed in the Texas prison system.